context for tuning in, so I'm Willy. I'll be talking about ligage resilient connections and true seed extractors. This is joint work with Sin Lee, Fermima, and Daniel Wicks. So throughout this talk, we'll be interested in key exchange, where you have two parties, Alice and Bum, who'd like to agree on a shared key. But they do not start with such a key to begin with, so they'll have to execute some protocol. And at the end of a key exchange protocol, Alice and Bum will be able to agree on some uniform key. So we'll be considering some particular cases of key exchange, in particular non-interactive key exchange, where the messages that Alice and Bob send to each other do not depend on the other party's message. So in other words, they do not have to wait for each other's message to send theirs, and they could send them simultaneously if they wanted to. The kind of security we'll consider is security against passive adversaries. When there's an eavesdropper, Eve, who has access to the channel Alice and Bob are communicating over. And we want to say that even if Eve sees the messages that Alice and Bob send to each other, then the key that they agree with should look uniformly. And we'll call a protocol that satisfies those two properties a non-interactive key exchange, or NIKE. Throughout this talk, we'll be dealing with another layer of security called leakage resilience. So in general, Alice and Bob will be using some internal randomness in order to execute the protocol. And the basic question that leakage resilience asks is what happens if this randomness is unreliable? So that could be caused by several reasons. For instance, Eve could have some kind of backdoor access to Alice and Bob's devices and learn some information about those random coins. Or Alice and Bob cannot reliably produce uniform randomness needed for the protocol execution. So here, what we'll be considering is the bounded leakage ceiling, where Eve only gets a limited amount of information about Alice and Bob's states. So for instance, Eve will be looking at all of Alice's coins, produce a small digest, and do the same for Bob. In general, we want security to hold, even if Eve is given those leakages. So it turns out that this has been a very well studied problem before, and a generic method called privacy amplification solves this. But the solutions that exist require the use of some additional randomness. So Alice and Bob will have some additional randomness compared to the original protocol. And we can prove that the new scheme would be leakage resilient after privacy amplification, as long as those green coins are leak-free. So as long as Eve does not get any leakage on the green coins, then the protocol will be leakage resilient. But we do not really want to make such an assumption, as it kind of defeats the purpose of leakage resilience in the first place. So what we are considering here, seeing where we don't have this kind of random coins, when we call a key exchange leakage resilient, if security holds, if Eve gets some leakage on all of Alice and Bob's states that is necessary to run the protocol. So notice that if we allow such a leakage, it actually makes sense to consider leakage resilience in a setting where Alice and Bob start a secret key that they share in the first place. So that could be motivated, for instance, by them sharing a key, but then their state being compromised. So they know that some leakage might have happened, but they might want to refresh their keys somehow. And because this is a weaker setting than the public key one, we can actually hope for information theory constructions. So that's a setting we consider. So in particular, the leakage resilience will here allow Eve to get some leakage on Alice and Bob's entire state. So that consists of both SK and their random coins. Okay. So now I can describe our contributions. first contribution will be to consider this symmetric key setting that I just talked about. And we show that there's a strong connection between such symmetric key exchanges and some random extractor primitive that we call two-seed extractors. And it turns out that those two-seed extractors are in turn intimately connected with communication complexity. It turns out that using communication complexity lower bounds, we can get information aesthetic constructions in the symmetric key setting. Our second set of contributions would be in the public key setting, where a prototypical example would be the Diffie-Hellman key exchange. So you can think about that when I'm talking about public key Nike. One question you may ask is, for instance, is Diffie-Hellman leakage resilient as is? So we show a broad black box impossibility result, actually, that rules out some class of reductions for any Nike key under a large class of assumptions that we call single-stage cryptographic games. In particular, those cryptographic games include most commonly used cryptographic assumptions, including very powerful ones such as I/O. Then, given this black box impossibility result, we actually show how to build standard Nike that is leakage resilient in some alternate settings that kind of circumvent this black box impossibility result. So I'll detail what those are later. And so that's for the talk. I'll focus first on the symmetric key setting and their connection with two-seed extractors before turning to the public key setting. So just to recall, this is the symmetric key setting where you have two parties, Alice and Bob, who share some secret key. And what we want, we want some leakage resilient Nike in the end, but we'll consider a very particular case where Alice and Bob send their entire random tapes to each other as the entire protocol. So the protocol is literally Alice and Bob sending their random tapes. And then they'll be able to compute a secret key using some function f. So f will take as input the secret key and the random tapes that they send to each other. So for security, we want that this final key should look uniformly random, given those random tapes and the leakages that the eavesdropper gets. So what we notice is that this has a very strong flavor of randomness extractors. So you can consider the secret key SK to be the source of an extractor, and the random test that Alice and Bob use as a seed. So to be more precise, let me define what two-seed extractors are. So a two-seed extractor will take three inputs as input, a source and two seeds. So compared to before, the source again will be the secret key and the seeds will be the random tapes of the parties. So for security, what we want is that for all leakage functions, then the output of the extractor should be uniform given the seeds that the party use and the leakage that the eavesdropper gets. So what it means is that the source is jointly correlated with the seeds, with each of the seeds independently, and we would like still the seeds to extract some fresh randomness out of the source. Okay, so the question now is, how do we build extractors, such extractors? And to do so, we rely on communication complexity. So in communication complexity, you have several parties, Alice, Carol, and Bob says, that want to compute some function over their inputs, so they each have some inputs, and they want to compute the output of some function over the input, so that they'll communicate with each other and try to predict some value. So the question we're asking is how many bits do they have to communicate to compute this output? So we'll consider a slightly modified version of communication complexity, where instead of just having one input, you can imagine that each party has a card on their forehead and can not see what's written on the card on their forehead, but can see all of the other cards. So in particular here, Alice won't be able to see X1, but will be able to see all the other inputs, and similarly for the other parties. So we'll say that a function big F has communication complexity comma F, if in order to compute F we say some good probability over random inputs, say, then the transcript that is generated by Alice, Bob, and Carol has to be at least comma F. And because the F we are considering here only has one bit outputs, another way to phrase it is that the size of the transcript has to be larger than this communication complexity in order to just distinguish the output of the function from a freshly uniform output. So this naturally gives a connection with an extractor. So in particular, such a function bf would be a number on forehead extractor, in the sense that the output of the function looks uniform, even given the transcript in the number on forehead model that is smaller than the communication complexity of F. So this is an observation that has already been made before. And we also know how to build efficient functions F with high communication complexity. Okay, so how does that help us? The claim is that any such number on forehead extractor is actually directly a weak truth extractor. And the main reason is I can simply rewrite the inputs so that the leakages that is given to the distinguisher can actually be seen as a valid number on forehead transcript, where here only Alice and Bob speaks in the picture above. So in particular, again, if the leakage functions have output size smaller than the communication complexity of F, then we have indistinguishability from random. Okay, so we are not quite done yet, because what we wanted in the first place was a strong extractor where the indistinguishability should hold even given the seeds. So that's what we just showed, and what we'd rather have is the same, but conditioned also on Rn, Rb. So in the paper, we show that actually the construction above can be directly extended to have strong extractors instead with some parameters. But the intuition behind that is that we can convert any distinguisher for this strong version into a distinguisher for the weak version using the fact that the output of the distinguisher is, in some sense, again, a part, can be thought as a part of a number of on forehead transcripts. Okay, so let me switch gears and turn to the public ECD. So the basic setting is this, where Alice and Bob share some randomness. Each have, independent randomness and exponents. And Eve gets some leakage over those random codes. So for concreteness, you can think about this leakage to be the Diffie-Hellman exchange, as is written in blue. So the basic question we ask is, what can we hope for in terms of leakage resilience for leakages? So can we even get any construction whatsoever? And if we're more optimistic, what can we hope out of, say, the Diffie-Hellman key exchange? can that be directly leakage response? So in order to state or impossibility results, I'll have to define what's a single stage cryptographic game. And such a game involves two parties, an adversary and a challenger, where the adversary is efficient, but the challenger is not necessarily. And at the end of the interaction, the challenger can decide whether the adversary won or lost the experiment. So the assumption that will be underlying is that for all efficient adversaries, the probability that he wins is negligible. So this captures all common assumptions that we use in cryptography, again, including powerful ones such as I/O. And if you're looking for a counterexample, well, leakage resilience, at least with respect to black box leakage, is a two-stage game where there are two, in some sense, two states of adversaries, one leaker that will generate the leakage, and one distinguisher that gets the leakage. And those adversaries cannot communicate with each other. Okay, so we are not ready to state the black box impossibility result. And the result states that there cannot be any black box reduction from the leakage resilience of an AK to any single-stage cryptographic game. And by black box reduction, I mean a reduction that treats the adversary and the leakage function as black boxes. So it's unfortunately a quite broad impossibility result, so that looks dire. In particular, it covers this leaky version of the Diffie-Hellman key exchange. So in particular, this shows that we won't be able to prove the leakage resilience of the Diffie-Hellman key exchange based on standard assumptions, at least with respect to black box reductions. But fortunately, there are some limitations to this impossibility result, and we'll see what they are, and thankfully they will give us some ways to build positive results. So the way we prove this black box impossibility result is using the meta reduction technique, that is a beautiful technique to prove those kind of results, where we first assume the existence of a black box reduction that converts any adversary for leakage resilience into an adversary for the cryptographic game that we assume. So in particular, if we assume, so the proof will go as follows, we will assume that there's such a reduction, in particular, it will be efficient, and it will turn even an inefficient adversary for leakage resilience into an inefficient adversary for the cryptographic game. So that doesn't contradict anything, this is fine. But the main insight is that if there's such an inefficient adversary for leakage resilience, that is, can be related to an efficient adversary for leakage resilience in a way that they are indistinguishable in terms of black box access by the reduction, then we can also use this reduction to convert this efficient adversary into an efficient one. So that the adversaries for the cryptographic games are indistinguishable. In particular, this new efficient adversary on the bottom right is actually a generic adversary for the cryptographic game. So in particular, this black box reduction gives a generic attack for the cryptographic game. But notice that this we did so without breaking generically the leakage resilience the key exchange. And the reason is that this adversary, efficient adversary for the key exchange, is syntactically not really an adversary. It's cheating somehow. But because the inefficient adversary is not cheating, the black box reduction cannot make the difference between them. In particular, this is still gives a good attack to the cryptographic games in the end. Okay, so the only thing we have to show is how to build such adversaries. So in the case of key exchange, we'll build our adversaries as follows. The inefficient adversary will have some random oracle hard-coded in its head, and we'll produce the leakage using this random oracle. In order to distinguish if the leakage matches the initial message, then the adversary simply brute force the final key. And in particular, as long as the null key is perfectly correct, then this gives an inefficient adversary for the null key. Okay, so how do we simulate such an adversary? The idea will be, instead of having a real random oracle, we'll simply program the random oracle on the fly and record the queries. So that's what the efficient adversary will do. And we'll simulate the adversary on the left, again, by defining and sampling those fresh leakage values h of p on the fly. And then, in order to break the leakage resilience, we'll simply look at the queries made so far. In particular, as long as the leakage is large enough, then this efficient adversary simulates the adversary on the left in a way that is indistinguishable from the point of view of the black box reduction. Okay, so this gives our impossibility result. In particular, it deals with black box reductions and schemes that have super logarithmic leakage and perfect correctness. So those three points can actually be seen as limitations of the black box impossibility result. So one may wonder what happens if we relax any one of these. And actually, in the case of small leakage, we can show that any null key remains secure if the leakage is sufficiently small. However, in terms of black box reductions of perfect correctness, we do not have any constructions, and we leave as an open question the construction of leakage reducing null key by just using either non-black box reductions or schemes that are only statistically correct in the first place. So another way we can circumvent this impossibility result is through the use of setups. So such setups might include, say, a common reference string that a trust party might generate, or what we call leak-free pre-processing phase. So what is that? Alice and Bob will now, before starting the execution of the protocol, start with some random coins, and we will pre-process them into some state in such a way that the random coins that you start with are leak-free. But that kind of goes at odds with what we wanted in the first place, that is a leakage resilient null key that is that does not use any kind of leak-free randomness. But the main point here is that in our model, in the leak-free pre-processing model, Alice and Bob do not need those coins to execute the protocol. They only need it to pre-process the state, and afterwards they can discard it. So as long as, for instance, their devices have not been compromised before the execution of this pre-processing, then the protocol would remain secure. And we actually show positive results in that aspect. We first show that assuming pairings and symmetric key net key that we built before information theoretically, then we can build a leakage resilient null key using both setups, that is both a common reference string and a pre-processing. And the techniques that we use are heavily inspired by the so-called dual system framework. So a natural question that remains is, what if we only would only like to use one setup at a time? And we show a plausibility result that says that assuming I/O and lossy functions, one can have a leakage resilient null key using either one of those two setups. So in particular, our black box impossibility result only dealt with schemes in a plane model, And it turns out that if we allow setup, we can actually get positive results as well. To sum up, we initiate in this paper a study of leakage-resilient non-interactive key exchange that does not rely on any leak-free randomness of the parties. We first study the symmetric key setting and show that this is closely related to some notion of randomness extractors that we call true seed extractors. And we show how to build those true seed extractors leveraging communication complexity lower bounds in the number of on-forehead model. In the public key setting, we show a quite broad black box impossibility result, but also identify some caveats in this impossibility result that allows us to actually produce construction, either in the small leakage settings or using setups that are the either a common reference string or a leak-free preprocessing. So thanks for tuning in, thanks for your attention, and here's the link for the input.